February 19th of 1942, several weeks after the bombing of Pearl Harbor by the Japanese military, President Roosevelt signed what was known as Executive Order 9066. Executive Order 9066 authorized the forceful removal of persons deemed to be a threat to national security. Most of them, the vast majority, being moved from the western coast of the United States to internment camps further inland, places like Utah and Colorado, big wide open spaces that were previously unpopulated. And so the question is, what was it that qualified people to be considered, to be deemed a national threat to security? What do you think that would be?
Spies.
It was actually that they were Japanese, right? So over the next few years, what this would result in, the implementation of this executive order, would be the incarceration into internment camps of over 120,000 Japanese Americans. And this was not substantive, as if they were threats. Like, one of the responses here was they were spies. This wasn't substantive. It was more proactive. It was preemptive incarceration. And it was not only of Japanese men, but it was also women and children. And it was essentially, it was a fear-based reaction to something that had actually happened. Okay, there was a precipitating event that was highly destructive. But the response to that was a fear-based reaction that colored everyone with the same brush, right? So many Japanese Americans during this time lost property, lost their businesses. There's many stories of children being separated from their parents. The civil rights of American citizens were just completely disregarded during this period. Over 120,000 people. And you talk about that number, that's, you know, it's a big number and it sounds big, but and it's like this kind of like, but it's kind of intangible. And you stop and think about it, those 120,000 people represent 120,000 stories of what they experienced. 120,000 lived experiences of being perceived to be a threat and having your rights taken away as if you were the cause of something destructive that had happened. So let me just share one story. Let me introduce you to Masaki Takano. Moss, he actually went by Moss. Moss was a nine-year-old, actually second-generation Japanese-American. When he was 9 years old when the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor. He was born and raised in Alameda, California. He was the youngest of three. Here's a picture of Moss with his mom. Moss recalls growing up in essentially a pretty diverse community in Alameda prior to Pearl Harbor and the U.S. entering into World War II. He described his classroom environment at school as being filled with a mixture of Caucasian children, Japanese children, Chinese children, and he said we all kind of intermixed. He doesn't recall there being prejudice until Pearl Harbor. And suddenly he found himself isolated. He found the nicer Caucasian students wouldn't talk to him and ignored him. The more vigilant ones or violent ones would call them snide names, referred to them as Japs. They found the Chinese students who had intermixed with them previously now distancing themselves from the Japanese students because they didn't want to be, you know, guilty by association and perceived to be Japanese. And so actually they had Chinese students wearing handwritten signs identifying themselves as "I'm Chinese, not Japanese," so that they would not be the targets of harassment as well. Masaki recalls how a few days after Pearl Harbor, Japanese Americans were put on curfew and instructed that they were not to leave their homes after like 6 or 7 p.m. in the evening. And then each day would bring stories, new stories of FBI arresting some leader within the Japanese community and taking them away to somewhere that no one knew where. Families didn't know, didn't know when they would be back. And so Masaki's father, pictured here, Masaki's father he was actually a leader in the Japanese community, specifically of their religious community. And because of that, their family lived in fear that his influence and his leadership role would make him a target for suspicion and therefore incarceration. And Moss shares in the video I watched him telling a story, Moss shares how the black car that mysteriously parked outside of their house every evening did nothing to allay their fears that their father was the target of suspicion. So Moss recalls one Saturday afternoon when he went to the parsonage of his church to visit his friend. His friend's father was actually the minister of their church. And so Moss arrived just in time to see the FBI arresting his father, his friend's father, while his friend's mother, who was pregnant, and also the four children that they already had. So basically family of five children, all the children and wife are crying as their minister father's being led away by the FBI. That family actually would remain separated for 3 years and would not be reunited until they were placed in the same internment camp some 3 years later. That August, Masaki's own family was forcefully relocated to an internment camp in Colorado. They were loaded onto trains with closed curtains. They were transported to the Amashe Relocation Center, where they would spend the next 3 years. Here's a photo of the really hospitable environment, the Amashe Relocation Center in Colorado. They were loaded onto trains, carried there. Masaki's family would spend the next 3 years there until eventually being allowed to return to Alameda. Masaki entered into his freshman year back in Alameda, California, but was now one of the only Japanese students in the school, and his fellow classmates recognized him as Japanese and treated him as such. And so he recalls being the only Japanese student and spending the last class period of every day plotting his exit from the school, trying to think through his exit strategy, because he got chased home from school every day by people wanting to harass him. Can you imagine having to plan your way home from school, plan your exit, because people hated you because something that someone else had done? Masaki Takano, he died in 2023, survived by three children and five grandchildren. So brings us to our topic today. And what we're talking about is hospitality that must resist fear. Hospitality that must resist fear. And we see the situation in which there was a genuine event that happened that was destructive, that was painful. And yet the response to that was to color a whole group of people with a broad brush and then treat them as such. Treat them with fear, suspicion and fear. In the series that we're in right now, it's a series that the big picture, it's called Beautiful Resistance. And what we're doing on Sundays is we're working our way through the texts of Ephesians. It's a letter that the Apostle Paul wrote in the first century to be a circular letter shared with churches about what it looks like to be a follower of Jesus in a broken world. That's essentially what the substance of the letter is. Meanwhile, in this series, in our life groups and in our personal reading, we're working through this book by John Tyson and using it as a discussion guide in our life groups. It's called Beautiful Resistance. And so this is the chapter we come to today, is that there's this thing that happens in human culture that is suspicion and fear, and that as Christians, we're called to resist it. The big picture, kind of the umbrella over this whole series, is an invitation, maybe more than an invitation, actually an instruction, that as followers of Jesus, we're called to be something more than just an echo of human culture. We're not just called to reflect back to human culture the same thing that's coming at us. And we're not just called to be the best version of the human culture, just, you know, taking it up a notch and like, well, we're not quite as bad as they are. We're actually called to be an alternative, a kingdom alternative. What's sometimes called an upside down kingdom, but we would say it's actually the right side up kingdom. Everything else is upside down. We're called to be an alternative to human culture. We're called to reflect and refract the person of our Savior in ways that are faithful to who he is and faithful to why he came. It's important to what we're gonna talk about today, who he is and why he came. So this week, we're going to look at three things under this banner of hospitality must resist fear. We're going to look at three questions, and the questions are this. What is it that we must resist? Why must we resist it, specifically as followers of Jesus? Why must we resist it? And then the final question of how. How, practically speaking, how can we go about resisting it? So let's start with what must we resist. I wrote it this way. We must resist the fear that permeates our culture, that informs many of our personal opinions and judgments, oftentimes subconsciously, which then translates into our behaviors and our actions and reactions. Our author this week, he puts it this way. He says, it's the fear that can cause us to prioritize our lives over others. This is what happened. So it's what happened there. We talk about 1942. People's lives were prioritized over others. And when that happens, it becomes this zero-sum game in which we think, in order for me to have what I want, in that case, people wanted peace, they wanted security, they wanted vengeance, somebody else has to lose, right? That's a zero-sum game. In order for me to win, you have to lose. And what happened there is the civil rights, the freedoms, the dignity of a whole population was subverted and set aside in the name of peace for others. And looking back, we can look back on that and we can go, well, that wasn't right. But the reality is that type of thing still happens today. I would suggest that fear is the water that our culture swims in. It's the air that we breathe to the degree that we often don't even recognize it for what it is. It's so prevalent in human culture, in the way that things get communicated, in the way that positions are defined, that we don't even recognize when we're being encouraged to respond and react in fear. And so the object of our suspicions and fears might change. And by the way, the topic is hospitality must resist fear. I'm going to unpack that word fear with a few more descriptions, because if we just limited it fear, we might allow ourselves off the hook for other things that should be included in this, which I would say are things like suspicion and whatnot. So while the object of our fears may change from person to person or group to group, in other words, what you fear and what I fear and what you fear might be different, but the overall common denominator is the same. It's this being motivated by suspicion and fear that puts people at a distance. So additionally, generally speaking, this is a fear of people that are different from ourselves in a fundamental way that matters to us. And this is important, because there's lots of differences. If we zero in on our differences, there's lots of differences. Many of them don't matter. You have a different hair color than I do, or you have more hair than I do. Most people have more hair than I do, okay? That's a difference that you know, it's not a source for division. But there are differences that deeply matter to us, and those are the ones that we're talking about today. So I just want to surface a few of them, because I don't want to leave this theoretical. I want to give us the opportunity to actually consider our own hearts, our views, our opinions, our judgments, our suspicions, and to hold those before Jesus and say, Jesus, do you want me to continue with this thing, right? So I want to surface a few of these that might be relevant within Christian circles, and maybe just listen for one that might be relevant for you today. So sometimes we're suspicious or fearful of people who hold to a different religion. Okay. Maybe they've rejected religion altogether. Maybe they were at one point Christians and have deconstructed. It's a whole group of people right now who would call themselves ex-Christians or deconstructed Christians. And sometimes within the Christian community, I hear a fear about this group, a suspicion that's at a distance. It's fear. Maybe it's people who are LDS. Maybe it's people who are Muslim. Maybe it's people who are New Age or Eastern religion. Or maybe there can be suspicion, take out the maybe, sometimes there is suspicion of people within Christian circles, but that hold to maybe a different tribe or a different stream. So there can be suspicions of Catholics or Pentecostals or Charismatics or Reformed people, right? Maybe the suspicion and fear is because someone's on the opposite side of a social issue that matters deeply to us. So you might think about matters like abortion or Second Amendment and gun control or economic policy or policy about foreign immigration and whatnot, right? Perhaps someone who will be voting differently than you in a few weeks. It's like just 4 weeks away, a little over 4 weeks. Somebody who wears a different hat, has a different bumper sticker on their car. If you had this experience where you pull into a parking lot and the open spot has a car with a bumper sticker that you really disagree with, right? What if it's at the church parking lot? I think it's a little messy, doesn't it? Maybe it's racial differences. Maybe it's educational differences. Our author this week points out that as an Australian, he has a national difference with, he lives in the U.S., he's pastors in New York City. He says, but as an Australian, I don't find that to be something that is off-putting to people. Usually it's something that people are highly interested in. But not all people from different nations or races experience that. Maybe it's people who hold a different view of morality or of sexuality or of gender. Here's what happens. The very fact that they may be different from us creates a distance in which our fears can grow unchecked. And why? So why is there this distance? Well, the reason is because, first of all, just the way things are, we tend to interact with and surround ourselves with people like us, right? Our social circles, our group environments, our participation, we tend to interact with and associate with people who think like us, who value like we do. Those are the people that get fed to us in our news feed and in our social media. And the people who agree with us and think like us, that affirms and confirms what we already think, and it confirms us in our rightness. And so the easiest path is just to surround ourselves with people who think like us, and then we can kind of go, yeah, I mean, the world out there is crazy, but like, we're right, right? And oftentimes it's not just we're right, but we're good and they're bad. We're righteous, they're evil. And at a distance, it's much easier to make those sort of judgments, right? Meanwhile, the judgments, the suspicions, and fears about other people can go unchallenged. And much of that is because we are not in face-to-face relationship with people who hold those differences. So in that distance, we often assign to people who think differently, we assign motives and agendas to people who are unlike ourselves. We oversimplify complex issues as having a good side and a bad side, or a righteous side and evil side. And here's the thing, that fear of others, if left unchecked, it has a downward and destructive progression. Looks something like this. So here's the downward progression. It starts with difference. There's a difference between myself and someone else. And we're at a distance. We don't actually talk about it because I'm surrounded with people who think like I do, and we all think that we're right. But in that distance, what begins to happen is distrust and suspicion begins to grow. And then it becomes easier to devalue not only that individual, but whole groups of people who think like that, the them. Right? We start using language like them or they. And the devaluing can go into actual disliking other people, disparaging them, talking about them, whether, you know, social media or whatever. The disparage can turn to actual disdain. Disdain can devolve into dehumanizing them. And dehumanizing can go into actually being okay with destroying someone else. Now, that's first of all, that's not a scientific progression. You won't find that like, well, there's a scientific test. I made that up, okay? But it's got pretty good alliteration. You gotta like the alliteration there. But I just thought about it. I just thought about how do these things happen? How do we end up with these type of atrocities that we look back on 1942 and we say, what happened there? We look back on, you know, things like the Holocaust. What happened? How did a group of people become so marginalized and devalued that somebody was okay with them being destroyed? How did they get there? Well, there was a progression. Left unchecked. How did slavery in North America happen? How did we treat other people with such disdain and devaluing that we were okay with slavery? So lastly, before we get to why we must resist the suspicion, I want to consider one more dynamic of this cultural norm, and that is this. Why is the fear of the other, or them, why is it so prevalent and dominant within our human cultures? And I want to suggest that there's internal reasons that are within ourselves. There's also external reasons. So internally, why is this so prevalent? Why do we tend towards fearing or being suspicious of people who think differently, live differently, value differently? Why do we have that tendency? And I would suggest one is because it's easier to paint whole groups of people with a broad brush, because that frees us from having to wrestle with uncomfortable complexities. When someone believes or values something passionately, but they're on the other side of something, it requires humility and moving towards them to try and understand where they're coming from. And it's hard work. And honestly, it's so much easier. The path of least resistance involves just surrounding ourselves with people who think like we do, vilifying the other side, and then just continuing this whole trajectory. Resisting suspicion and fear of others who are different than ourselves, that's not the path of, or resisting that suspicion is actually not the path of least resistance, because it requires humility and intentional effort. So there's internal reasons, there's probably more than that. But externally, why is this so prevalent within our culture? And externally, I would say this, because fear is an incredibly powerful motivator. Fear is a very powerful motivator. If I can feed your fears, I can then leverage your fears for my purpose, for my gain, right? For example, if I can get you to fear other people, I can get you to give to me. People will often open their wallets out of fear. If I say, look, if you don't give right now to this thing, and if you don't give enough, here's how that plays out. And people will open their wallets because of fear, or use their app. If I can get you to fear others, I can keep you following me. If as a pastor I stood up here and I got you to fear all the other churches, I could say, look, if you, there's no one who's actually really preaching the word, but we are a Bible church. And if you come here, I'll keep you rooted in the Bible, but you go out there and man, you're in trouble. If I get you to fear others, I can keep you following me. If I can get you to fear others being in power, I can get you to give me power. If, for example, if you don't vote for me, here's what you'll get. Or if you let them get elected, here's what they'll do. Do you hear it? I want to encourage you over the next 4 weeks to just listen. Listen when you get the ad in the mail, when you get the commercial on TV or the ad on the radio, whatever it is, all the politicking that's going on, listen. Don't just listen for who it is, but listen for that thread of fear and how so much of it is fear-based, and it's leveraging our fears for the gain of someone else, right? And we're to resist that. I want you to pay attention to it, not only when it's the side that you might already be suspicious of or fear, but when it's your side being cast that way, and what you might find is yourself saying, they're not portraying us correctly, right? What they just said about my side isn't true. That's a straw man argument. They're taking it and reducing it to something and it's not true. That's not, but you realize the other side feels the same way, right? No one thinks of themselves as evil, bent on the destruction of our democracy. But both sides will tell you that's exactly what the other side wants to do, right? As followers of Jesus, we have to resist being part of that culture and that economy. We're called to not only to not participate in that ourselves and to not feed into it, we're called to actively resist it. Here's why. Why must we resist it? Because the very core of the gospel is Jesus coming towards an othered humanity with sacrificial love and reconciliation instead of suspicion and fear and judgment. It brings us to our text today. We're going to be in Ephesians chapter 2. And in Ephesians 2, before we get there, I'll just set it up a little bit. Paul's arguing for unity within the church. And what he's talking about, he's specifically arguing for unity between followers of Jesus who have historically been at enmity with one another, who've held suspicion of one another, fear of one another, hatred of one another. They've been separated by adherence to religious law. They've been separated by nationality. They've been separated by differences that kept them suspicious and fearful of one another. And so where Paul begins is by reminding his readers, and again, we remember that Ephesians was designed to be a circular letter shared not just with the immediate recipients, but shared to other churches, including us. What he reminds them of is their own human condition before Christ came into their lives, right? God in the person of Jesus was not content in them being the others. Jesus came towards them in self-sacrificial love in order to, the text actually says, and I didn't use this translation, but one of the translations I looked at this week said, and so he was killing the hostility, which is such a cool phrase, killing the hostility. You know, we every week come up with new band names. If I could submit that one this week, killing hostility, like, I like it. All right, here's our text, Ephesians 2:11. So then remember this, in human terms, that is, in your flesh, you are Gentiles. You are the people, the so-called circumcision, referred to as the so-called uncircumcision. By the way, these are not names that were just used for clarity's sake. These were names that were spat out with contempt towards one another. Uncircumcised dogs, right? Circumcision, of course, being something done by human hands to human flesh. Well, once upon a time, now listen to the stacking of descriptions here. Once upon a time, you were separated from the Messiah. You were detached from the community of Israel. You were foreigners of the covenant, which contained the promise. There you were in the world with no hope and no God. Similar passages we've looked at previously in Ephesians, Paul has this way of like stacking his descriptions in order to make a point. And so every brushstroke, it's like he's painting a picture and every brushstroke contributes a unique feature to, but the overall picture that he's painting is one that's very bleak. He's painting a picture of their separation from God, their hopelessness, the separation not only from God, but from his covenant people. But fortunately, Jesus didn't leave them in this situation. He didn't leave them in this being othered, who were separated. Verse 13, but now, that's again, we have two words that are so important. But now, in Messiah Jesus, you have been brought near in the Messiah's blood. Yes, you, who used to be a long way away, he is our peace, you see. He has made the two to be one. He has pulled down the barrier, the dividing wall that turns us into enemies of each other. He has done this in his flesh by abolishing the law with its commands and instructions. Verse 15, the point of doing all this was to create in him one new human being out of the two. So making peace. God was reconciling both of us to himself in a single body through the cross, by killing the enmity in him. So the Messiah came and gave the good news. Peace had come. Peace, that is, for those of you who are a long way away. Peace to those of you who are close at hand. For through him, you see, we both have access to the Father in the one Spirit. Amen. Which brings us back to the question, why must we as followers of Jesus resist the suspicion and fear of others that permeates our culture and keeps us at odds with whole groups of people? Because receiving the gospel doesn't stop with our personal relationship to God. God desires us to be reconciled to others. In fact, Paul goes on in Corinthians to say, God has given us the ministry of reconciliation, where we are to go out as ambassadors of reconciliation. Paul just said that the gospel is not only vertical, like this, between man and God, it's also horizontal. He said, through the cross, Jesus established peace with God, but also peace with others. So the gospel is actually made complete in us when we love others the way that Jesus did. And Jesus loved others who were previously considered enemies. That is why not only Paul, but the other biblical authors as well, insisted. Paul and people like John was, we're gonna look at a text from John in just a second. John was one of Jesus' most intimate, closest friends during Jesus' ministry and incarnation. Peter, James, and John, they were the three that were always with Jesus, even when not whole groups were, they're always with Jesus. And John, along with Paul, insisted that our reconciliation with God must be translated into the way that we treat other people who we might have previously seen as enemies. Listen to this. This is 1 John 4:7. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God, and all who are fathered by God and know God. And all who love are fathered by God and know God. The one who does not love has not known God. Because God is love. This is how God's love has appeared among us. God sent his only son into the world so that we, who were formerly distant, we should live through him. Love consists in this, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son to be the sacrifice that would atone for our sin. Beloved, if that's how God loved us, we ought to love one another in the same way. N.T. Wright, in his commentary on this very passage, says this. He says, the Christian faith grows directly out of and must directly express the belief that in Jesus the Messiah, the one true God has revealed himself to be love incarnate, love put on flesh. We would say Jesus came and made the invisible God visible, right? And what he showed us was love. Those who hold this faith and embrace it as the means of their own hope in life must themselves reveal the self-same fact before the watching world. Love incarnate must be the badge that the Christian community wears, the sign not only of who they are, but of who their God is. That's a great quote. All right, so if I gave us a pop quiz today, pop quiz is already a surprise, right? That's the nature of a pop quiz. If I gave us a pop quiz today and I said, all right, just curious, how many of you would say that we're supposed to love other people? I'm guessing 100% would get that one right. It's like that's the big E, and it's the big E on the I chart, right? Sunday school answer, who did this? Probably Jesus, right? Should we love others? Yes. So I think we would pass the quiz, but the question is, do we actually pass the test? Do we love others the way that Jesus has loved us? Remember how Jesus loved us? You think about that description of who we once were before Jesus entered into our lives. He loved us undeservedly. I know I didn't deserve it. He loved us unreservedly. His love for me has never run out. It has no limits. It just keeps going on even when I fall short. He's loved me unconditionally. When I fail, he continues to love me. Amen. He loved us while we were his enemies. Do we actually love other people first before they love us? Are we waiting for people to admit that they're wrong before we love them? Because that's not what Jesus did. He entered into our world while we were yet sinners, while we were enemies, while we were opposed to him, and he came towards us in love. That's the very definition of hospitality, is coming towards another person in sacrificial love. That's the standard. It's how Jesus showed us the Father, and it's how he calls us to reflect God's image in his name. So before we get to our final point, I just wonder if you can consider this. We've talked about different groups, but there's lots of different groups that we could think of as opposed to ourselves or distant from ourselves, groups that we might talk about or think about. I'll be honest, in my own, as I've been in this week, I'm good at keeping my mouth shut, but in my heart, I can disparage other people. I keep it clean on the surface, you know, so nobody knows. But he knows, right? He who searches the heart. And I invite him to do just that. I guess, God, would you search my heart? Try me and know my thoughts. Search me and know my heart. See any way in me that's unpleasing to you. Anything that distorts your image to other people. And transform me from the inside out. So would you just, I'm not going to ask you to share what it is, but if there's, I suspect that we're doing well with loving some people, but the standard isn't how well do we love people like us. The standard is actually how do we love people that are unlike us. That's actually when our Christ-likeness comes out. And so who is that for you? Who is it that you're just annoyed by, irritated by? What people groups do you have judgments with? What people groups do you not have any interaction with? Here comes the last part. How can we then resist? We can actively resist the cultural trend of suspicion and fear of others different from ourselves through acts of hospitality in which we open our lives, our schedules, our homes, our tables, our wallets to individuals that are previously from that othered group. I emphasize individual here, actively resist the cultural trend with individuals because we have limited opportunity to interact with whole groups of people. For example, election season. If you are, if you find yourself in one political party over the other, you don't have many opportunities in the next 4 weeks to interact with the entire other political group. But you could interact with one person from that group. You could interact with them in a way that was hospitable, humble, curious, loving. We can make space for personal relationship with another person in ways that help us to love them, to better understand them, and to maybe stop fearing and vilifying them. I was reminded of this really helpful test this week. The test is this: get to know the other side of whatever the other is. The other argument, the other belief system, the other value system. Get to know the other side so well that you could communicate it on their behalf and they would go, yeah, that's what I believe. Because oftentimes what we do, as I said earlier, is we create some sort of straw man idea about what another side is like. And when we hear that done to ourselves, we go, well, that's not what I believe. Get to know the other side to the degree that you can say, let me get this right. I think this is what you believe. And they would go, yeah. And if you can do that, you will close the gap and be able to love someone without vilifying them as evil. To do this, you have to sit with somebody in humility and curiosity. So I'm going to close with this, just a way to make this portable. You may have previously heard me make this statement. I've shared this in various environments, but this is a leadership maxim that has been really helpful for me. It's do for one what you wish you could do for everyone. And I'm not going to unpack that leadership maxim right now, but I want to personalize it for this morning. And it's this: do for one what Jesus did for you and what he did for everyone. Because the gospel we just read in Ephesians was not just about those who have received it. It's also about God's desire to do that for everyone. And if we're the ambassadors of that message, we can't at the same time hate people and keep them at a distance and also share that loving gospel with them. We have to choose. And Jesus would require us, would insist that our posture be one of love, not hate, not suspicion, not fear. We're the ones who can bring healing to this. And unfortunately, many would say that the current, in within the current climate, some of the most angry and hateful things that are being said or posted or done are by people who are claim Christianity, people who have verses in their bios. Must not be. And so the invitation is for us to repent ourselves, to open our own hearts and minds to God and say, God, would you search me and know me? And whatever you see in me, would you convict me of that? That I would repent, and then would you give me an opportunity to act differently, to do for one? And when you do for one, your heart will change for the whole. I promise you. And close with a story. A couple years ago, it was actually the winter of 2023, January of 2023 specifically. This happened at our home. Andrea and I have two daughters. Both were living at home at the time, and we also had a house guest living with us for several weeks. And that January, we noticed that we live on a corner lot, and we noticed that there was a car parked outside the fence that we didn't really notice all the time because it wasn't in the front of the house, but we would notice it when we pulled in and out of the driveway. And it's not uncommon because we're on a corner lot. It's not uncommon for there to be cars that aren't ours parked there for a while. But this car didn't leave. And after a day or two, we began to wonder, and we began to notice things about the car that previously didn't really matter. It wasn't a very nice car. In fact, it was didn't look like it ran, which maybe was why it was there. It was also packed full of junk, packed full of just stuff that made it probably hard to drive. And we began to wonder, you know, what's the story with this car? We didn't know what the story was, but we wondered and we began to create stories. And so within our house, it's like, what do you think that is? Maybe, what should we do? Should we call the police? Should we have it towed? Like, this is after a few days, right? This car just sitting there outside of our house. See if there's somebody dead. Well, that's probably, we didn't go there, but I'll tell you where we did go. And so I noticed as I was pulling out one morning, it was there. And when I came home, it was still there, only I could tell that things had changed. There was towels in the window and blankets. And we began to wonder, is somebody living in the car? And as we talked about it, we tried to come up with the story that we didn't know what the story was, so we tried to come up with it. And our stories were all over the map. And of course, they were some of them were suspicion-based. And some of them based on other experiences of life created fear. Like, do we need to protect ourselves from whoever is living in this car? And, you know, I've got daughters living here and our house guest was concerned and you know. And so that night, I remember one night I went for a run and I decided I'm gonna go and just knock on the window and see who's there. And I didn't know what was gonna happen, but I thought, well, I stop creating a story, just move towards it, right? But I'll be honest, I was a little bit fearful, not necessarily of who might be in there, but how they might think of me. Like am I gonna be perceived as a threat coming up and knocking at, January nighttime, knocking on somebody's window? Would I be perceived as a threat? And so I knocked and nobody was there. And so I went for my run and I came home and I just remember that night though being bothered by the thought that I think somebody is living out there. And I looked at our home and the fact that we had heat and our dogs had a more comfortable life than this image bearer of God or image bearers of God who might be living out in that car. And I just remember being bothered by that and praying and feeling conflicted because what do I do? Do I go out and invite total strangers into our home and potentially put my family at risk? Like, I don't know. So what's my obligation to my family? What's my obligation to my God? I was conflicted. The next morning I was driving to work, just pulling out of the driveway, coming down here to work, and we start most mornings with worship and prayer. So I was heading down to the church to worship Jesus. And as I pull out of the driveway, I notice that something has changed in the car again. It looked different than it did last night when I went for my run. Like, towels are different than it. So I thought, I'm going to try again. And so I stop and I turn off the car and I go and I knock on the window and there's some rustling in the car and finally the window rolls down and this pretty young guy says, hi. And I said, hi, my name's Trevor. I live here. And he started to go into, and I was like, hey, wait. I said, I just wanted to check on you, see if you're okay. And also like, see, can I take you to breakfast? And he looked at me like, why would you do that? And I was like, I just love to hear your story and get you a hot meal. So he's like, well, yeah, can you give me 15 minutes to clean up? I said, sure. So, and I'm thinking, do you have a bathroom? Because like, so 15 minutes later, we go out for breakfast, asked him what he was hungry for, and he didn't care, just something hot and good coffee. So we went out for breakfast. And over breakfast, I sat there and I just said, well, tell me your story. And over the conversation, he became a real person. Instead of becoming the homeless threat living outside of our fence, he became Taylor. And a young guy with a story and hitting a lot of obstacles and just trying to get a leg up, but was stuck. And I found some things that I could move towards him in a way that was hospitality.
Was it drugs? Any drugs involved?
I don't know if there's drugs involved. But I helped him get a phone. Got him a hot meal. Got him another sleeping bag. I said, are you doing okay? You sleeping out here? He's like, yeah, I'm fine. He's like, I'm young. But what he's waiting for was his friend that was trying to help him with his car. And the car had been stuck there for days and he couldn't get a job. And so I helped him out that day and prayed with him and then went to work. And I came home that night expecting to connect to him again. And by the time I got home, his car was gone. And I never saw him again. But what happened in my heart is I realized that God wanted me to move towards people, not in fear, but in love. Amen. And that's what hospitality looked like then. It didn't look like, in that moment, I didn't feel like God was asking me to, and it wouldn't have been appropriate for me to invite a complete stranger to come live in our home, in our current situation. But I could still move towards him. Do for one what I wish I could do for all. I can't impact all of the homelessness in our valley. I can make a difference for that guy, right? So here's my prayer this week, is that we'll get a chance, or maybe if not this week, in the near future, we'll get a chance to act in ways that are hospitality based, that break down walls, that help us to better understand people who've been on the other side of something. That we'll have opportunities to get curious and to get humble. And instead of lazily vilifying people who think differently than we do, to sit face to face with somebody and ask them, why do you think the way you do? Why do you vote the way you do? Why do you live the way you do, right? So I'll close with this. And maybe like this is my closing prayer this morning, and then we're just gonna make some space for ministry. But would you stand with me? Because what I wanna do, we've done this throughout this series, is we've closed with gospel readings. And this particular gospel reading is also the Apostle Paul, but it comes from his letter to Titus. And this is probably my favorite, you know, gospel in a nutshell. It's one that I've memorized and pray through regularly. I thought, let's pray through it through this lens, specifically of hospitality towards others. So come, Holy Spirit. As we open our own hearts and lives and our thoughts, our opinions, our judgments, Lord, as we hold our lives open to you, we thank you for the gospel that has come to us. And Lord, for the gospel that you want to see reach others that don't yet know you. God, as we root ourselves in your gospel, would you lead us? Would you give us opportunities? Would you orchestrate our lives in such a way that we get opportunities to challenge our own perceptions, our own judgments, our own fears, and to find that your image bearers are equally valuable to ourselves.